First of all, I'd like to thank Audrey for welcoming us on your lands. And thank you for all the people that are in the same mindset and wanting to protect Mother Earth and coming to learn from each other. I come from the Unis'tot'en people who have occupied our lands for thousands and thousands of years and have been taught by my grandparents, parents, to how to stay connected to the land. If we weren't taught how to stay connected to the land, I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing today. Because my true belief is if people are spiritually connected to their land, you're going to do everything in your power to ensure that you protect it. And our problem in this planet today is that so many of us are very disconnected. We are in a state where right from preschool, right into post-secondary education, we're brainwashed. We're told we have to buy into this economic wheel. We're told we have to get an education. We're told we have to take a job. We're told we have to get a mortgage. We're told we have to do all those things to be a part of the state. And it's this system that's destroying the planet. Because greed has taken over, that industry and government is all about their bottom line. They don't care about our waters, they don't care about the planets, and all of these people live in the big city centers or even from other countries that come into Canada and want to do these projects. And it's our people that have to live in the lands, it's our people that depend on these lands that are going to be impacted. So we have pipelines trying to come through our territory. And we've actually had exploration trying to come into another one of our territories to, I believe they were looking for copper and gold. But we kicked them out probably about 4 years ago. We evicted them off our territory, but because of these the bigger issue with the pipelines trying to come through the last remaining 10% of our territories, like all of our other territories are already impacted by agriculture, mining, and one of the big mining companies that's owned by Imperial Metals is called Huckleberry Mines that is on our people's territory. And that one went in and they signed agreements with Indian Act bands again who don't have jurisdiction on our territory. And they made promises of jobs, they made all these nice promises that there were going to be all these jobs and everything, and there's probably not even 1% of our people working in that, and it's already been running for 10 years, and they've already destroyed like mass areas of land, taken off mountaintops, and this was all done under the Indian Act bans. So we managed to stall that exploration, but because of the pipeline was a more prominent threat to my people, we started putting our focus on blocking those pipelines. Because we believe that if we can't win all our battles at the same time, we had to pick and choose which one we had to focus on. And so right now we're focusing against the pipelines that are trying to, there's Enbridge that was trying to transport bitumen from the tar sands to Kitimat, then there's PTP, which is a company that's owned by Chevron and Apache. And Coastal GasLink is another new, and these ones want to transport frack gas from the Fort Nelson area up into Kitimat as well. And probably about 7 years ago, a traditional use study had been done, and the Hereditary Chief of the Wet'suwet'en had said 100% no to these projects. So the province came up with this wonderful idea to put some money forward to what they call the First Nation Limited Partnership Agreement. So they managed to get 15 bands to sign on, and then if everybody had listened to the media lately, they said the 16th band they got to sign on was Morristown, which is the band I come from. The company came to our community twice, and all the community members, a high majority of them said no to these projects. But our band council disregarded our the people's wishes and decided they wanted to go forward and sign the agreement anyways. And in that agreement, it said that it had a no oil clause and said that the pipelines could not be changed into an oil bitumen pipeline for 5 years. So we questioned them, why would you put that in as a clause if you weren't planning to do that? So our suspicions were correct. We were suspicious right when we first started doing this that the whole intent was always for the oil pipelines. It wasn't for the fracked gas. That, because they started out with a 36 diameter pipe and now it's up to 42 inches. And you can guarantee that if we had somebody to go check those pipes, the walls are probably thicker because they need thicker walls to put the bitumen through. So we knew all along that these corporations are dishonest. They've always, and government and industry, they've always been dishonest to our people for hundreds of years. And our position is, why should we start listening to them now? They make promises to things are going to change for our people, but it never does. The rich get richer and the poor stay poor. And the poor people are the ones that are going to be impacted by these projects because they depend on the salmon, they depend on the moose meat. Everything that comes off the land is their main food, because if you look at a single person that's on assistance because they're unskilled, because our people suffer with so much social problems because of the residential schools and Ministry of Social Service, the 60s scoop they call it, where, and it's still happening today, we have like the highest number of Wet'suwet'en children that go into care. And a lot of our children have lost their culture and get disconnected and displaced from our lands. And when you're displaced from your lands, your spirit, it's just like your spirit dies. And I experienced that myself. I was bought into the system. I thought I had to get a job, I had to get an education. So I did all that and I worked as an economic development officer for 14 years for my bank. And in doing that, I paid off my house, 5 vehicles. I still was not happy with my life. I thought something was missing and I kept trying everything that I could think of. And when I started going back to the lands as I did when I was a youngster, it just felt like my spirit was coming back alive. I got my health back. I used to have severe allergies where I had to take meds every day and I had to pack around an EpiPen and I used to wear eyeglasses. But after being back on our territory for the last, going on 4 years now, we've been living in a cabin at a blockade. And I don't like to call it a blockade because it's now my home. I live there. I've given up my house to my daughter. I told her that she could have it under one condition, that she fill it up with grandkids. So I just outright gave it to her and moved out to the territory, and my health has improved quite a bit. And when we first started doing this, we didn't feel like we had that much support from our people. It was just my family, and then Toghestiy's clan joined us, and then now we have 4 of the clans that have stood up in their fee system, which is our governance system, and announced that they're saying no to all pipelines. Before, everybody was just saying no to Enbridge because they were buying into that lie that frack gas, which they call natural gas, they keep using that term through the media to sell it to the people that it's clean and it's just going to dissipate if the pipes break. So a lot of our people had bought into that, the political structure, that like the Indian Act system is different than our hereditary system. The Indian Act system was imposed on us by the federal government probably about 100 years ago, and it's not really a decision-making power. I always say it's just a group of people that sit around a table to implement the Indian Act for the federal government, because they don't truthfully have any decision-making power at that table. And our hereditary system has been intact for thousands of years, and our people still have that intact, and it's run through our feasts. I belong to the Toghestiy clan, and there's 4 other clans, and the head chief, it's their responsibility to ensure that they're taking care of the lands and ensuring that all of the clan members have equal use of these territories. So that's the government system we still have intact, and we've told the industry, sent the industry letters, and we sent the government province letters saying that Indian Acts don't have jurisdiction on our territory. The pipelines aren't going even through any one of those reservations. The reservations are the only place that they have jurisdiction on. Just like municipalities, they have a boundary, and around that boundary, that chief and council can only make decisions within that boundary based on their policies that come from Indian Act. So we haven't accepted that these pipelines are going to come through. We're still saying a firm no, and we will do everything in our power to ensure that they do not come through. And as I mentioned earlier, that our belief is if our people are healed through, whether it be spiritually, mentally, and physically, as what we want to do with the healing center. We're building a healing lodge on our blockade, as they call it. Because our strong belief is if we could bring our people back to the land and help them heal from all the oppressive things that have come against our people through racism, through the murdered and missing women and residential school, all the abuses that came down and children in care that went through abuse. Those systems did their job to try and take the Indian out of our children, and we want to create this healing lodge to put the Indian back in our children. Because if they have their culturally strong in place, then they will stand strong and they will protect the land. And we won't be able to do this unless we all join forces, because the government has no power unless the people give them that power. We, the people, have the power. And it's important for everybody to make their voice heard when you don't agree with the decisions that this government is going, the direction they're going right now. They're reducing all the protection of our waterways, and they're reducing all the legislation that's supposed to protect the environment just so that their projects can just be pushed forward. It's we, the people, that have to put a stop to this. People have power. Reclaim your power and start protecting the land.
There's a lot of things that we could cover over these few days, but I think some of the most important is the discussion around strategy and building a campaign that involves all people from all walks of life. I'll quickly talk about the free part informed consent protocol process. It's I remember when the United Nations developed the UNDRIP, and they kind of announced to the world, you know, the people or corporations need to approach Aboriginal people from the onset before the idea goes onto paper. They have to actually sit down and talk with the Aboriginal people. And it was a United Nations declaration. It was really, really powerful, and it caught the attention of a lot of people around the world. And as most of you know, Australia and Canada were the last two to actually even seriously consider it. It was adopted by just about every other country out there as part of the UN, but Australia and Canada decided, yeah, well, that doesn't apply to us, and we're going to sit and think about this first. Which gives you really a strong idea about what we're up against. Not just Indigenous people, but everybody. The corruption that goes deep into government infrastructure is a corruption that has taken over this entire landscape and is showing itself in so many ways. Like, I heard a presentation from a Tsleil-Waututh a couple of days ago. He was saying they used to gather seafood just across the inlet here at low tide. He talked about all the different types of fish and shellfish that they used to gather there. And they can't do that anymore. There's nothing there. When the tide goes out, there's nothing at the table for them. That happened. That's happening everywhere in our territory. Like, I grew up with my grandparents, Sa’itne and Madeek. They brought me throughout all of our traditional territories, hunting, fishing, and trapping, and all the seasons. And going out there and just getting a chance to, like, enjoy the land and be a part of it, to taste the land, because the land has a flavor, and you cannot connect with the land unless you've actually tasted it. And we do that now. That's what we do. We live out in the territory. We hunt, fish, and trap out there. The majority of the food that we set at the table comes from the lands that were protected. And that connection that we have is deep. There's a lot of supporters here that came and visited our camp, and they can identify with that. They know what goat meat tastes like. They know what moose meat tastes like. Deer, beaver, groundhog, salmon. They know what the flavor of the food is, and they know the story about how that food got to the table. And you can't say that for a large part of the planet. You especially can't say it here in the city. When we've been eating here, it's really hard to eat because we only eat traditional foods and traditional protein. It's hard to eat in the city because, you know, everything has got cruelty meats. Everything has beef, chicken, pork. Animals that were caged for their entire lives so that it could be slaughtered and fed to the masses. With no storyline, with no respect to the life that they lived, with no ceremony, with no prayer, with no recognition for who these creatures were and how they eventually got there. And that's hard. It's the disconnect that the majority of the population has with this earth is amazing. You don't taste, you can't taste it. And that's one of the key things that we try and teach people when they come up to the camp. You need to connect with it, you need to love it, you need to understand what ceremony is and how to do that ceremony. We'll teach you our ceremonies, but don't go teaching everybody else like it's yours. It's sacred to our people. Learn other people's ceremonies if you're in their territories. Learn your own ceremonies. Do those ceremonies with everything that you're doing. Drinking water from someone, there's ceremonies around that. There's ceremonies for like digging medicines out of the ground. There's ceremonies for taking some leaves off of a tree. There's ceremonies for when you walk up to a significant geographical, geological feature out in the territories, out in the lands. There's ways of approaching them, and we need to bring all that back. We need to respect the earth that we walk on. We need to escape from capitalistic claws that try and disconnect us and keep us separate from the environment that we all depend on. We need to unplug ourselves. So we have a pretty amazing camp. It's a lot of work that went into making it happen. There's some key individuals in the room here that helped us right from the onset and watched us walk through the baby steps. When we first started building this campaign at Unis'tot'en camp, it was a mega project. We were a small group of people up against office buildings filled with people just doing their jobs, who represented billions and billions and billions of dollars. And we had no real solid infrastructure. We didn't have a foothold. We didn't have an idea of what our future was going to look like. But we slowly kept working towards this idea that we were going to occupy our lands full time. And that's what we've been doing. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of physical work. If anybody comes up to the camp and works with us for a while, we'll understand. You know, it's a lot of physical work. It requires a lot of labor. Living down on the land is not an easy thing. And it should never, ever be an easy thing. So this campaign that we've been building is it started off as a local campaign, building it up in the camp. Getting more awareness out there, starting a Facebook page and a website. First of all, I think we started a blog, and then we moved to a website eventually. Well, we've been getting a message out that, you know, we're out on the land now, we're stopping these pipelines. It's a place that we're occupying full time, the same way our ancestors were. So we spend a lot of time out on our traditional territories talking about the history of those territories, the ancestors and how they carried themselves and how we recognize them with everything we do. And it takes a tremendous amount of energy, but the reciprocity that you get from doing that exercise on your ancestors' lands is amazing. Like, a lot of energy goes into just existing and living up there and doing ceremony constantly. But the energy and the love that you get back from the spirit of that land is tangible and real. You can feel it. It envelops your entire body. Even if you come up and visit for a while, it's an amazing experience to go back out on the land that the ancestors know are being protected again. They're all there. As soon as you cross over that bridge and go through protocol, if you're lucky, as soon as you cross over that bridge and you make it through protocol, something takes over you. Like you walk into it's like you walk through a veil. And the spirits are alive out there. And as long as you carry yourself in a truthful and a humble and respectful way, they're going to reward you with an amazing amount of love and understanding and wisdom. And that's what comes from a lot of work and deep respect for your lands. And acknowledging the spirits, acknowledging ceremonies, and knowing that that connection that you have with that land is going to help you protect that land for many, many generations down the road. But if you have a lot of settlers out there who come out and they can identify with that. As soon as they get back, they cross over the bridge, you're like, wow, I can't believe I was gone that long. What an amazing feeling. I'm glad I'm back. It just feels amazing. It's truly, it's tangible. You can actually feel it. It's not a symbolic gesture of recognizing our ancestors. It's something that's real. We can actually feel it when we're out there. And people, like I said, there's a lot of people who come out and visit us at the camp. They can identify with that. It's real. And that's how you connect with the land. Frida talked about the need for a lot of people to begin walking this path towards creating a connection to themselves and their land that they're walking on. Because once you do that, you fall in love with that. And once you fall in love with that, you're not going to give it up for anything. You start to build a relationship, an honest, true relationship that does have reciprocity. You have to exercise reciprocity in that relationship. Because you're going to take from that land and you're going to give back to her. And our way of giving back to her is making sure that she never ever gets damaged. There's rivers that flow through the territory that are nurseries for the salmon that our people have lived off of and sustained ourselves from for thousands of years. We have ceremonies for the first salmon that come up. We have ceremonies for for the way that we dress the salmon to care, but we have ceremonies for consuming it. We have ceremonies for discarding the bones that we give back to the waters and the land. And that deep love that you develop stays with you forever. And I encourage everybody to find a way to connect, to find a way to fall in love with this earth again. Because if we're going to win this fight, we're going to win it with a true, deep sense of love that will drive us forward into a future that will benefit all of our unborn generations. And there's a lot of prophecies out there that talk about who's going to survive at the end of this big end event. And a lot of us have heard these prophecies over the years. And a lot of us understand that those prophecies are what will determine our actions today, tomorrow, and the days following. But a lot of those prophecies spend a lot of time trying to teach people about what I've just been sharing with you. Understanding that there's a deep love for this earth and falling in love with it and using that love to drive you forward to protect her is something that is tangible. We have people that come out to the camp sometimes and full of military fatigue, a huge backpack on with all this survival gear in, and they've got like hatchets on them, and they're like, I'm gonna fight. I'm here to join you guys, and I'm gonna stand here and I'm gonna protect this place. And they're like full of bravado. And we get to put all that stuff away. And we start bringing them out on the land and teaching them stuff. And some people don't have the patience, like, well, I came here to be a land defender and I'm not doing it, you're just showing me all this stuff. And I'm gonna leave. And I'm like, well, that's fine. When you're ready, come back. But there's some people who have gone through that and they've actually taken the time to sit down and learn about what we're doing and what this is about. And once they've learned that, they've realized that this has changed me. Something inside of me has changed. Something inside of me understands that. And they begin to move forward and towards that. And that's what we're building. We have a couple of camps coming up. There's a spring action camp that's coming. It's the first 3 weeks of May. And we're asking people to come out and join us in this. We're looking for volunteers. You don't have to have construction skills. You don't have to have kitchen skills. It'd be good, but you don't have to. And we're looking for volunteers and people who can kind of donate in one way or another to come out and join us out on the land to assist us in building the healing lodge that Freda was talking about. There's a healing lodge that we're building out on the territory that is going to be there for many generations on. And it's a beautiful, beautiful structure with an incredible vision about how it's going to work. And it's very connected to the land, the territory that we're protecting. But we also have an action camp coming this July. I believe it's July 8th to the 12th. It's a 5 days of, I think it's $75 for you to come up to the camp and pay. You pay on our website, we're gonna have a link on there that we'll talk about the action camp. And there's a PayPal account on there, just pay the $75 and register. But we get people from all over the world for both of these separate camps. They show up, it's just an amazing experience. So you get a chance to kind of build solidarity and friendships with people from different parts of this planet that you otherwise might never have had a chance to do. And that's something that I just wanted to end with, to see if you can look into being a part of what we're doing up there. It's an incredible experience. My friend Richard here is also doing the same out in Madeleine camp. They're building up some incredible infrastructure up there, and we're really proud of them for what they're doing, and I think they deserve a big hand for what they're doing. So, look us up on www.unceded.com, or you can check us out on Facebook. We don't tweet, so you're not going to find us there, but you'll find us anywhere else on the web. What's that?
It's a privilege and honor to be here, especially amongst all of these warriors and land defenders that I have so much respect for and admiration, and they really inspire me to continue on even during hard times. So I'm the Bukong Cree. I come from the Peace River region. I think he's pulling up the PowerPoint. I was going to show some pictures because I feel like sometimes photos really help folks understand the kind of immensity of the tar sands, which is where our communities are from, and also how it's connected, which I think a lot of people here know, so I won't kind of repeat. I'm gonna go quickly and then get to the bones of the issue at the end. But here's a map that people have probably seen before, and you can see all the infrastructure that's all around that needs to support tar sands and fracking and mining. Next slide. I'm gonna stand up. So this is the Alberta Tar Sands. I don't know if people have been there before, but it's 141,000 square kilometers, the size of England and Wales are the size of the state of Florida. So 23% of the province they're looking at completely destroying for surface mining and underground mining. Next slide. So from one of them, you know, there's many Indigenous communities, Métis, Dene, Cree, and it's just many communities that are up there. And this is just a little, one of the community that I come from out of, you know, many of the communities that are there that are experiencing these impacts. That's my kukum, who was, you know, lived off the land. She didn't speak English. She was traditional. Our family comes from, you know, having medicines or chapon, similar to what Toghestiy was talking about. Had, you know, my dad tells me stories of having like hundreds of medicines across in the cabin, you know, and now like how there's very few that we now harvest because of all the extraction happening. And that's my dad up in the bush. They hid him from residential schools until about the age of 10, so he didn't speak English either, and then finally went to a day school, and those were just as horrible, but better than being gone for the whole year. So this is one of our community. We already have 2,600 oil and gas wells in our traditional territory, possible plans for nuclear, millions of dollars, billions of dollars actually being taken out of our territory, yet my family still has no running water. This is a map that was done by Amisyu International that shows the 70% of Lubicon territory that has been leased for development. You can see where my family lives, that little star, little buffalo, and all the different oil and gas leases around. And also 1,400 square kilometers of leases granted for tar sands extraction. So as you can see, our community has endured three decades of massive oil and gas without the consent of the people, many blockades throughout the years. And then, you know, how does this tie into the mines that we have? I talk about the mines because these are as big as entire cities. You know, you think of Imperial Oil, which is one of the latest mines. It will be bigger than Washington, D.C. when it's done. So we're talking about huge swaths of land. You know, when we think of the tar sands, it's hard to really express the immensity of it. This is one of the tailing ponds that we flew over. We took this picture. This looks like a lake. This is actually toxic sludge pool, you know, where we have millions of liters of toxic contaminants every day leaking into the Athabasca and Mackenzie River Basin. And why is this so important? It's sacred water that's being destroyed, it's being consumed and destroyed at the same time, where we have a sixth of quote-unquote Canada's fresh water supply, where, you know, we have the complete drainage of this from the Athabasca Basin, which goes into the Peace and the Athabasca Delta, which drains into the Mackenzie River Basin up north. And so we have the underground mining. I think a lot of folks have a harder time understanding what this is, and this is right by where we're from. We have Shell, we have an underground mining happening since I was born. And what this is when they super heat steam and push it under the Earth's core with chemicals, so it's similar to fracking. And that's 80% of the way in which they'll extract tar sands. So this is one of the smaller ones. This is taken from the air, where you can see huge swaths of, you know, the seismic exploration through the trees and then later into the piping. This is a projection just to give you an understanding of what we're talking about when we talk about all the, you know, we have over 100 operations already in the tar sands and then the mines, about 7 going on to 8. And this is one community that's where we have the healing walk. So people have been to the healing walk before. Anzac and is the first Fort McMurray First Nation, is the land that we would have our camp on. And this is what shows what will be, how it will be completely fragmented and destroyed. This is a satellite image from space. As you can see, the mines up there, just nothing, and then just the fragmentation, which is why we talk about, you know, I'll show you a picture, but like the woodland caribou that will be extinct by 2040 within our lifetime because of this type of extraction. And then the steam leaks and explosions, which we have, you know, 300 meter crater right by a community of Fort Mackay. You can see the explosion just melted the Earth's core and exploded up. You can see the earth, the bitumen, and also just the pipeline leaks. This is a natural gas pipeline explosion. Then also the health issues like H2S's, S2O's, like all of the respiratory illnesses. We took this outside. This is the Shell, when coming into the Shell area in the Peace region. So you can see the poisonous gases. Those are dotted all along the landscape. And then the boreal, which is one of the last remaining intact forests in the world, which is being, we're now number one in deforestation in the world. We've passed the Brazil and the Amazonian forest for deforestation because of tar sands extraction. And so you can see the before and afters, before, after. is what reclamation they're talking about. Oh, we'll reclaim it, we'll make it back. And no, this is not where we can harvest medicines. This is not where we can, you know, hunt, fish, and trap. This is not where we can practice our rights inherently as Indigenous peoples. They call it equivalent land use capacity. So this type, you know, what we see is over and over and over again is this type of extraction. We took this, I was on top taking pictures. This is just dead trees, they leave. And so what we see is an Indigenous way of life being overshadowed, where we can, you know, we can harvest medicines and berries and plants, and now we can't. And, you know, my dad talks about tumors in the carcass of a moose, three, like, yellow meat. You know, that's what we are left with, where we have to go further and further out from our territories to even just hunt moose. So the woodland caribou extinct, the lynx, the song, migratory songbirds. So this is kind of what we're having. It's cultural, what we call cultural and environmental genocide. Further encroachment on the land, contamination, and this is what we're left with, you know. So we have cultural, we did this cultural camp at Fort McIver week before we started doing the healing walks. I'm cutting moose meat with my family, and you know, that's taken up in Athabasca region where they're smoking fish. And this is the type of landscapes that we're left with, you know. The Trans-Canada Natural Gas Pipeline along our traditional territory in the Athabasca region, and then also gas flaring. And then how does that relate to, for us, the irresponsible climate change that we're pushing on our Indigenous brothers and sisters, or brothers and sisters all over the world that are experiencing impacts from climate change? And then the last thing too is an oil spill that was in our traditional territory, which was, you know, one of the largest ones in Alberta's history. It was 4.5 million liters, 28,000 barrels that just spilled right outside of where my family lives, you know, about seven miles away. So my family could hear, could feel and smell the waft of the fumes coming in for weeks. This is taken from the air, so if you actually look, those are people, like tiny people there on the bottom. So this is completely consumed. The muskeg we call, where we pick medicines from. Closer up, you know, a lot of my family ended up having to clean it up. You know, they're looking for workers in the area, so that's my family, one of my cousins cleaning up. You know, my sister having to, like, coordinate all of this is like that, you know, what we were brought in to clean up their messes, essentially. Another picture we took from the air, another one on the ground when they finally let us in after fighting with the company for a number of weeks to be able to see. Another one from the air we took, those are small, the white or hazmat suits, those are actually people that are cleaning up, and that's the muskeg you can see, and all the oil that's going in all the different tributaries that will be leaching into the waterways, which was never accounted for, and there was never any emergency response plan for our community, so therefore people were breathing in these fumes. My cousins and my auntie texting me saying, like, why, what is this, what are we breathing? I think it's a propane leak. No, actually, it was a massive oil spill, and the government didn't inform the community for 5 days after, and then a doctor I talked to said pregnant women shouldn't have been in the community, elders shouldn't have been in the community, small children shouldn't have been in the community, and there was nothing done and said to the community. And that yet, you know, this is 15 months later than when they said they had reclaimed the area, which they didn't. You can see this is just a dead zone. It's a complete, like, lack of life, where the elders talk about having, you know, mosquitoes or any bugs along the surface of a water. It means it's good, it's, you know, cleaner and more alive. And this was just like silence. It was dead. And we could see footprints from different animals in and around the area. And so, you know, these are my cousin's kids, and a lot of people were just exposed, and no one was told to leave. So one of the things that we did do for a number of years, and we're trying to do more training camps now, because we did about, for 5 years, we did the healing walk, because the elders had asked us to start doing a healing walk. They didn't want to protest, they didn't want to demonstrate, they wanted to walk in prayer for the land, and that's what we did, and we followed what they had asked us to do, and we eventually got, you know, a number of hundreds of people out. I'm probably sure that some of the people in this room came to that. So we're trying really hard to start bringing inspiration, because I know when I started doing this work about a decade ago, I was really, I felt super isolated. I felt really sad. You know, I remember seeing the beauty of the land. I remember seeing, you know, when I was a child going on horse and wagon with my grandmother and grandfather, and seeing how beautiful and pristine and vast our traditional territory was. And as I got older and I kept going back home and seeing all the horrible expansion and all the logging trucks and all of the, you know, heavy haulers and all this equipment coming in and out of our territory and having no control. And it feels really alone and isolated, but throughout the years, it's been really amazing to see all people coming together from all walks of life, really joining with our communities. And one of the things that I'm going to be doing this summer is a big fuck you to the Alberta government, the Canadian government, by coming up with solar projects. I've independently fundraised for solar panels to go up right beside the school to inspire the young people to know that there is another way to produce energy, to produce, you know, what we are now being taught is trying to live this lifestyle that is not our lifestyle, that is an imposed lifestyle that we don't have to have. But it's pretty amazing to know that there's technology out there that is actually more in line with our Indigenous ways of being and thinking, and more in line with our Indigenous ideologies. And so solar is one thing that actually does give me inspiration. This was taken when I went out to visit the Sioux First Nation. You know, what they have solar panels on their administration building, fisheries building. You know, they have one of the biggest solar panels in Western Canada, and I don't think we'll get that big yet, but this is one of the communities that I was really inspired from. And I know there's a lot of other communities like ACFN and other communities that are actually doing this, and our community will be one of those communities this summer. And one of the last things I wanted to end with was making this connection between violence against the land that we see happening all over Turtle Island. You know, we see violence again and again through different forms, through colonialism, imperialism, capitalism, all of these neo forms of colonialism. And, you know, one thing is that we now see it's being more visible, even though we've known for years that there's been massive violence against our women, because the value of our women's lives are not the same value of other women's lives across this country. And the reason why I speak about it, in the past I wouldn't have, because I would walk in these walks, but now my sister was one of those young women that was taken from us. She graduated, you know, she moved to Toronto because she wanted to get her quote-unquote education. She was one of the young women in our families to be a cultural knowledge carrier. She, you know, as I did this work, the political work, trying to protect our land, trying to politicize our young people, she was doing the cultural components where she was learning how to make the hides and make our moccasins and do all the things that my cookums and auntie do, and to do the beading and to mix those two and to make the cultural revitalization happen in our communities and our families. And you know, when we have our women stolen this way, it's like a part of us is ripped away. A part of our hearts are ripped out. And yet the government refuses to do anything about it. The police refuse to even spend any time on her case, where she fell 31 stories and it's listed as suspicious, yet there's nothing. You know, the case is idle. It's been a year and a half, we finally got documentation back, where lawyers are asking, why isn't this a homicide? Why isn't this in being investigated properly? You know, and I'll tell you why. Because our women are not valued as much as the lives of white women in this society. And that's a shitty thing to hear, but it's true. And this is just the continuation and the perpetuation of violence. Violence against women is violence against the land, and the two are not separated. And, you know, that's why we call Mother Earth, Mother Earth, because she is, you know, we come from her, just like we come from a woman's womb. We were born in water. So, I think that's all I'm going to talk about, actually, but hi, thank you for listening.
Cookstown for all the speakers. And my heart goes out to my sister. She's correct in what she's saying and the truth about how they treat Indigenous women. And you don't know, unless you're a Native woman or a colored woman, how you feel, how it feels walking down the street at night and cars pull over and think you're working. That's the way that they think of us. But this is powerful women up here. We're not scared to step up to any man or their companies. So, first of all, I'd really like to say thank you for everybody coming out and listening. This is like an amazing conference. It's discussing a lot of issues. People are educating themselves, going to start thinking more critically about these issues. And it's really important to share our skills, and build our army to fight this state, this occupying country of Canada. So I have this map here that my sister put together of the Imperial Metals Mines in the territory. You'll see the shaded area of the Sahuatmoc Ulu, our traditional Sahuatmoc Nation's territory. Then, can you go back to the next slide? That first slide. So our Rudok Creek mine, it says Tum Tum area, that's our traditional area, it's called Chka. It's in the Upper Adams River area. And then Mount Polly, you'll see, is in the northern part of our territory. You'll see the Fandora mine, you know, Cat Face, Huckleberry mine up in the Unis'tot'en territory, then all the way up to the Red Chris mine. So what happened on that day? Well, first of all, I'd like to say we've been fighting Imperial Metals. Like, Imperial Metals is our enemy. We've been fighting them for years and years. When our hunters went up to that area in the Upper Adams and they came across exploration. So right now they're in advanced exploration stage, really pushing hard to get more permits from the province. So they came across it, and we organized many things up there: caravans, birch bark making, basket making camps. We organized a lot of things to get the community up there. I mean, it takes around 4 hours to drive from our community of Niskanen, but as an eagle flies, it's just right there, just because of the mountains and the lakes and the roads that make it harder for us to get to. But it's a beautiful area, and we're going to be taking more action there. We kicked them out of our community many times too. We went and smashed on their Imperial Metals AGM. So when that date came on August 4th, when the spill, the big, huge Mount Polly disaster happened, our people were already outraged at Imperial Metals, and this pushed it over the edge. And what it created, when we talk about what are the impacts of mining, we usually talk about the environmental impacts, but we don't never talk about the social impacts of how these companies come into our community and they find that one Indian, that one person in the community to say, yes, let's sign that dotted line, let's bring this mining company through. But the social dynamics that play out within our communities and our territories with the Department of Indian Affairs system, and you heard them talk about it, but I think it's really important for the settler community to understand who are the rightful decision makers on our homelands. Is it the Department of Indian Affairs, Indian agent, you know, chief and council system? And don't get me wrong, there are some good chiefs out there that are standing up with the people. But we have to look, are we going to be supporting and putting our energy behind that system? Or are we going to be supporting the grassroots people and the revitalization of our nations, our culture, our Indigenous governance system, and the rightful decision makers? And people need to, you know, really look at that and choose what side they're really on. So what happened on that day on August 4th, right after that, our community went and organized and had some meetings at our annual Shuswap gathering, And these are Sukwa'un territorial authority meetings. These are about who are the rightful decision makers? How are we going to get organized and structured within our nation? Real nationhood issues with the hereditary chiefs, the salmon chiefs, the matriarchs, the clan mothers, the youth, the hunters, the fishermen, discussing real important issues. And one of the biggest issue on the table in our nationhood was the Mount Polly disaster. How are we as the Sukwa'un Nation going to respond to the Mount Polly disaster? All eyes are on Mount Polly. How much news cycles that lasted in the news, but many people saw that footage, the horrific footage of what it looked like, this dumping 15 million liters of toxic sludge into our fresh water that dumped into Polly Lake, into Hazeltine Creek, into Quinnell Lake, which is the deepest glacier-fed lake in the world, Quinnell River, and then into the Fraser River. So what our people decided is we're going to go up there through our elders and the direction that we got from our nationhood meetings, to go up there and to light a sacred fire. Because we cannot act on our own, we have to have our spirits, we have to have our ceremonies to give that guidance and that direction. And so we went up there and we lit a fire. And yes, our hereditary chiefs were there, our salmon chiefs, but they said, no, it's the women. The women have to light the fire, because you're the ones with the power. The true power, because you know in your heart and soul what you're fighting for our children. We birthed those children. We held them in our womb in that water for all those months, and we birthed those children. And every decision that we make is for them and for their children. So we went up there and we lit that fire, and it was a beautiful ceremony. Clear sky. As soon as our elders start singing, big windstorm, big windstorm. And that fire was going, and we had that fire going for 14 days, and it was really hard because some people, 4 day, we'll have a sacred fire, but then people start coming, the likely people start coming. They start crying at the fire. Workers from Mount Polly start coming, contractors, people from all the surrounding the nations and territory start coming, because there was nothing in place as a crisis center. There was nothing in place, but we became an epicenter for people to come that were in crisis, that were in trauma, that were feeling pain of the unexpected. What is going to happen to our salmon? What is going to happen to our water? What is going to happen to our deer and our moose? And so a couple days after that, we're like, how do we get in? It's all secured. There's security everywhere. How are we going to get into Mount Polly? Everyone start coming out. We're going to take my boat. Let's take my sailboat. Let's go take this boat. Let's go out there. Everyone wanted to go out there and see with their eyes the impacts that it left. And so we got this one man to take us out on a boat out to the site, the Hazeltine Creek. And it was like a war zone. It was like a war zone. And so we went out there days after, but we went out there again 3 months after. And I have a short little 3-minute film of our visit 3 months after the spill.
Giving the truth out to the public or to our people, to our Sukwa'un people, about what really happened on that day. And now, almost 3 months later, we had to go in there so we could see for our own eyes what they were doing. And we had to bring the truth back to the people. Arriving at the site of the supposed cleanup or cover-up, there were workers all there, and they confronted us, they wanted us to leave.
Are you deaf?
No, I just don't care what you're saying.
Well, it doesn't matter. You gotta go. Let's go now.
They all left. They all left the site. We can see here on these big cedar trees how far the mining waste, all this sludge had come down during the initial spill and how high it was when it came through. And to us, it looks like a big cover-up and not a cleanup. We don't see no tailings waste getting hauled off. There's no big heavy haulers hauling any of these mining waste out of here. They just have these big piles of rocks. And to us, it looks like they're just covering it up.
It's the water that is still flowing into Quinnell Lake.
It's actually mining waste that's continuing to flow. And all that mercury and cyanide and arsenic and all those heavy metals and processing chemicals, it's leaching. After just being there and just seeing the color of the gray, there's no light, and you can't replicate that color anywhere in nature. It's like lifeless. I'm standing here at what used to be Hazeltine Creek, where Unis'tot'en, the traditional Sipatma place name for this area. This creek, it used to be 4 feet wide. Some people said you could just jump over it at some point, and now it's just a big, vast gash and gorge and scar onto our land here. And then the curious stuff that we developed over, they can talk to us. It was people that were hired by the band, and it's important for people to know that the chief and council of that band office system was invented and put in place by the Canadian government. So government and industry, they use that in order to give consent to push through with these projects, these mining projects and pipeline projects. But the people on the ground, the people that depend on the land, that are impacted by things like this, like the disaster, mining going through, or pipelines, the people that hunt, the berry pickers, and the fishermen, we are the ones that really inevitably are first impacted. And so we are the first ones to be able to make the choice on what happens on our territory. Consent for these companies needs to come from the rightful title holders, needs to come from the people, our collective nation, consensus amongst our whole entire nation, not band council systems.
Okay, you saw at the end it said Klavona Keepers. They're the ones from the Tahltan territory that are like facing the wrath of Imperial Metals right now with the push for opening the Red Chris mine, which is a brand new Imperial Metals mine. They got a permit to test out their tailings facility, so they're filling up their tailings impoundment area right as we speak. This is pristine beauty. It's like 20 hours plus drive from my community up into the far, far north. They just barely brought in the northern transmission line for Red Chris. Post-spill, through Murray Edwards, pumped up like millions, tens of millions of dollars for that, to finish off that northern transmission line. So they're all linked up. Everyone's linked up for industry, trying to make this the big, huge, new, you know, gold era and mining area for our peoples. But I wanted to like talk real quick too, is that this is just a really unfair battle that's happening right now, and we need support and we need power and we need people and the skills that everybody has and all the brilliant minds that everybody has, because we cannot do this just alone. We cannot just do this alone. So we need to take action. I know Caleb said this morning, like his recommendation to just take action. Don't wait around for someone to say, yeah, that's a good action to take. Just do it. We're always in need of fundraising. We know we're anti-capitalist, but then we also know that we need funds in order to continue on with our movement. So anyone, extra funds, organizing fundraisers for communities, for the people on the front line, is amazing support work. Also, this country of Canada, we say that the country is illegally occupying our territories. And we say that civilian occupation is a part of all of that. But we need to also respect that there is such things as pre and prior consent protocols. So we know that the people who are supporters and the people that are allies and the people that want to put their energy into fighting for this clean air and this clean water and that people are occupying, that we all need to wake up, we all need to have a responsibility for the areas where we're living on. We showed this map right here before. This is another, the Ohausit and the Tl'aukwit areas in the island. Sashin is here. We're in alliance and solidarity and continuing to join our forces to fight against Imperial Metals. It's a big company, and we're trying to, right now, we're going to be going in again to get some more, to go monitor exactly what they're doing, because there's not enough monitoring. The Imperial Metals have hired a spin doctor to go to all of their public events and to show their PowerPoint presentation with all the data from the water testing and from the salmon testing, and saying, everything is okay, Canada. The water's all right to drink. The salmon is all right to eat. But those standards are the lowest of the low of the low of the low. And we do not accept those standards, because the water is not going to be all right to drink. The salmon is not going to be all right to eat. We have to stand up and shut all these mines down. Forget about it. Forget about the mining policies that some of the bands are trying to push forth. That's a destroy Mother Earth policy, as I heard my elder tell me the other day. So this is an issue. Everyone needs to know that we are not scared to tarnish Canada's reputation. Canada is a violator of human rights. Canada is a violator of Indigenous rights. Canada is contributing to the destruction of our water and our homelands, and people need to stand up. I'm not Canadian. I'm Sukwamuk, and be proud of that in our fight. My time limit, but I just wanted to leave this word with you. This is the name that Mount Polly has, the area around Mount Polly. It says Yuch Nesen Chai Metwa, and people might have seen that around, but it's Yuch Nesen Chai Metwa, and it's a powerful word. It's an area. It's a word. It's the birthing waters. It's when the woman's water breaks, when she's given birth, and that's the power of that name. That's like where the water from Quesnel Lake spills into the Quesnel River. So Yuch Nesen Chai Metwa is a powerful name. People need to say it all the time, and we need to send our healing energy and the enlightenment that will come from that, and how we're going to battle and help with shutting down Imperial Metals, because this is a symbol of how they want to treat all of us and all of our land. Likhts Jam.
Okay, I'm gonna just sit here and do it, because this isn't my normal forte. I'm not really a big public speaker. So yeah, I think I only have a few slides anyways. The five slides on my PowerPoint took me a few hours to do. So my name is Melissa Daniels. I'm a registered nurse. I hold a Bachelor of Science in Nursing, and I am also a lawyer. I'm a lawyer for my nation. I practice you know, I fight Canada, Alberta, in the industry, in a captured system. So I think that sums it up. I'm pretty good. I acknowledge my bias, but I think that my personal observations and my analysis are quite well-founded. I'd like to thank the Musqueam people for allowing us on their territory. I actually had it written down here. Notes was to discuss this issue with traditional territory, how people always acknowledge, I'm on so-and-so's traditional territory, and I didn't quite understand it, because who are you acknowledging it to? Sometimes the people wouldn't even be in the room or anything, and so I really, I thought the way you introduced yourself, and you know, we had stated our intention, that was very powerful. And I think that, you know, going forward, that I would really like to start engaging in more of those sort of ceremonial practices. And, you know, when the people aren't in the room whose territory we are on, I think the very minimum we should be doing is acknowledging the violence that has taken place on that territory. So on that note,
I was mentioning, I am a lawyer. I work at Woodward & Company, which is based out of Victoria. I only represent ACFN, and this has to do with wanting to meaningfully acknowledge the sovereignty of other nations. I have no authority to be advising other nations on any sort of internal matters. And what this fight is really about for me, I grew up down in Fort Smith, which is a 3-hour boat ride from Fort Chippewa. That's how we measure things, like boat rides and stuff. I have family in Fort Chip and Fort Smith still, my mom, my family, everybody I know, everything I love. And so it's really nice to be here. I never get to speak, I'm always in a very adversarial sort of context with like lawyers and stuff, so it's so beautiful to like be a part of something where I feel like I'm being supported, instead of fought against. Isn't about pipelines. It's always been about the water. But to take that even further, I think that how Melina was beautifully articulated, this is about Indigenous women. And I don't think that the success of this movement or whatever, that we're trying to do, the solidarity efforts, it's not about how many projects we stop or how many pipelines aren't built. It's about how many women are not being stolen, because that's how we actually have to measure the success of the movement is, when I don't see any of my sisters going missing anymore. That's the true measure of success, because as the people of there's a Cheyenne proverb that's always really stuck with me, and that's, a nation is not conquered until the hearts of its women are on the ground. And then it is done. No matter how brave its warriors, no matter how strong their weapons. And I think that that's something that we all really need to internalize and move forward with. So this is my badass homie. She's my homegirl. We're from the same nation. And she was actually supposed to be doing this presentation, but was unable to make it and sends her regrets. For some crazy reason, she trusted me to take her spot. But if you ever get the chance to see her speak, I would highly recommend it, because she throws down treaty truth like nobody's business. I was like watching her videos on YouTube last night. Ariel Durange. Even though her whole family actually is like the most amazing revolutionaries I've ever worked with. They're holding the line in Saskatchewan with our Dene brothers, against the nuclear industry. They're just amazing. So as I kind of acknowledged in my, when we were doing our introductions, that I'm Dene Sultane, I'm a member of ACFN. We call ourselves the people of the land. My home is one of the most important freshwater deltas in the world, which is the Peace-Athabasca Delta. So when ACFN, the birth of ACFN, in 1889, a commissioner came through and they were trying to determine which number treaty was going to be next. And they noticed that, which would later become Treaty 8, had it was documented in 1889 that we had like the largest hydrocarbon reserve in the world. 10 years later, Treaty 8 was signed. The context of that is very, very iffy. Our nation signed in July 13th. 1899, after 4 days of negotiation, after Frank Laviolette, who was there on our behalf, was assured with absolute certainty that we would be able to continue our life as it has been. And this wasn't about rights, from what I gather from the elders. This wasn't like, we're going to have the right to hunt, we're going to have the right to fish. No, it was, we were going to be able to continue our lives the way they are, and I think this is very important, and I'll allude to it later because of the current work I'm doing. So, oh, next slide. So this is Dene Nation, and see what I was telling you? I'm not really good with PowerPoints. But you can see it's the drawing, and that's Turtle Island, and that's where the Dene people are supposed to be represented, and this is based on one of our traditional stories. It's not only just Dene Nation exclusively, though. This is also the caribou migration route. So this is Caribou Nation. This is all the other nations of all the other animals that live there. It's not just strictly Dene Nation. And I do have the better picture. Our council woman, Lorraine Hoffman actually wrote this book. It's called Inkoze, and so she's recorded many of our stories from our elders. And I just think it's a beautiful picture. So, next slide. This is Fort Chip when I was flying home to go hang out with my elders. This is Lake Athabasca. This is not a reserve. Fort Chipewyan is not a reserve. Well, at least it's not our reserve. Next slide. I'll show you our reserve. That's our reserve. Because what happened was when WAC Bennett Dam was built, it completely destroyed where we were living. And so it forced us, at that point we became refugees to Fort Chip. And we've since built a community there. So just to show you, you know, we're not just being impacted by the tar sands. And this is also why we're fighting actively against Site C as well. As I was mentioning earlier, I've maintained very close connections to my home communities. I've been blessed to be able to spend probably about half my time in either Fort Chip or Fort Smith. I've been spending a lot more time in Fort Chip recently, and I'm very blessed for this. When I first became aware of the negative impacts of the tar sands that it was having on the ecosystem was when I was working as a public health nurse in Fort Smith. And it was Dr. John O'Connor, outspoken, amazing medical doctor, who first came out with this, and he's so humble. I always credit him for why I went to law school, because that's why I went to law school, was because of his findings. But he's always told me that he's a messenger. He was just a messenger for the people, because people had been complaining about this for a decade before he came out, I think 2005, 2006. Okay, next slide. So this is when I was called to the bar. That's me and my chief. And you know, like, look at how optimistic I looked about the law, right? I was like, so naive to think this is a possible solution. Although I do acknowledge that the practice of like the Queen of England's law has facilitated in the slowing down of the approvals of projects. And it's actually done not a bad job. You know, Shells-Pierre Rivermine, for example, they just retracted their application because we slowed them down so much that it's no longer economically feasible. and Jack Pine Mine, we recently litigated this. It was under judicial review, the cannabis decision, well, the Ministry of the Environment's decision to approve this project. We had it judicially reviewed. And I'll discuss that a little bit more, but this project was first proposed, I think, in 2007, and it's still not built, and I'm really hoping that we won't be able to do it. And I'll just show you what Jack Pine Mine looks like currently. Do you want to show? So this is my flyover of Jack Pine Mine. You can see where they're trying to expand, right? With the testing, new core hole drilling. And what this project is supposed to do is increase production by 100,000 barrels per day for the next 25 to 30 years. So when the minister approved this, we argued that that the government had to not just consult with us, because consultation is nothing. If you really want to engage in that process and do this whole rights-based approach, you have to go for accommodation, because that's action. Accommodation's action. Consultation's like a letter. The challenging part was that there hasn't really been very many accommodation cases put forth to the courts. So not only that, we work in a captured system. The federal court judge, actually was the National Energy Board's in-house counsel for 10 years. but enough time had passed to not make her biased. You know, so this is like the system. This is the system I'm trying to practice. And we said that the Minister of the Environment, she could have used the Species at Risk Act to protect the buffalo and the caribou, two species that ACFN has like relied on, survived on, sustained on for like 10,000 years. And I know it's around 10,000 years because a mining excavation, you know, operation uncovered artifacts that were traced back to like 10,000 years ago. Spears with that actually still had blood on it were recovered. And there was also issues with the way the cabinet's decision was made in the approval of this project. So we filed for the judicial review in January 2013, and then our case was heard, January 2014, and then our case was heard in December 2014. And in between that time, the Chilcotin and Grassy Narrows decisions came out. So of course Canada's like, no, this is all Alberta. You know, and they just play this role. Like, I swear to God, I almost wonder if, you know, some of these court decisions and the way that it plays out or the way they change laws is if in response to litigation, you know, we just put this litigation forward, then these decisions come out, and it's, I just really do not have any hope in the judicial system or the Canadian government. So we received a decision in December, you know, of course. We lost, you know, because actually ACFM has never won a case, which is the truth of it, you know? That's how screwed up our system was. And I think I found this one really troubling because, for one, this isn't a case for me. You know, this is 100,000 barrels of oil for 25 years. You know, that's gonna impact the people, the animals, everything, the water, you know, just the water alone. And so it was then in December that I just got so frustrated with the law that I needed to take a break. You know, well, actually I said, I'm not practicing law anymore, but my chief's kind of yipping me back into it. And, you know, it was just that thinking that, well, this is a system that created the problem and is such we'll never find a long-term solution or even any sort of justice from the system that created the problem. So our entire community and way of being has been severely compromised by the tar sands industry. Okay, I was gonna talk about Fort McCabe, but I'm really running out of time. I wanna talk to you about a project I'm doing right now. I'm giving up on common law, I've decided to embrace our Ardennian legal principles. And that's what I'm doing. I'm doing a master's of science at Harvard, and my research is ecosystem-based land management that is founded upon our Ardennian legal principles. And so what I do is I've been recording all of the stories of our elders, you know, and I'm talking about stories about our relationships to the land. Lots of them involve animals, you know, like one of the stories, I guess I don't even have time to tell you a story. So. Okay, I'll tell you one of the stories. Okay, there was this one man. He was out on a hunt and he found this. It was like a bunch of burnt bushes, kind of like this, and it looked really soft to lie on. And so he thought he would go to sleep there for the night because it looked like a perfect spot to sleep. And in the morning, he woke up in his caribou-covered outfit, his caribou skin clothes, was all burnt as well. And so he was really frustrated, so he decided to set a snare. And he was like, I'm gonna trap whatever, you know, burnt me, and I'm gonna get him back. The next morning, he woke up, and what he trapped was the sun. And so, you know, all the animals and everybody was really pissed off at him that he trapped the sun. And they were trying to get it out of the snare, but no one could get it out of the snare. And then a mouse came along, and it was the mouse that was able to gnaw at the snare to release the sun. And then, you know, everything was cool after that. And so my job is to take that story and kind of interpret the principles, the legal principles that come out of it. And then I take my interpretation, and then I give it to the elders. I ask the elders, is this what it represents? Because I'm doing it all, you know, our relationship to the land. And so, yeah, there's inherent difficulties with it because I am still using a common law case approach where I'm looking at the facts, the decision, you know, that sort of thing. But if I don't start recording this stuff and implementing and basing our policies and our declarations and our constitution off of this sort of thing, then we really don't have like a substantial system to be like, yo, you know, like. So. What a treaty means. How would they know? They don't even know our legal principles, nor do they know the principles and stories of any other nations that signed the treaty. Treaty 8 means different things to all of us, you know, and it's not whatever the Supreme Court of Canada said in R versus Mikasu. So if I push this a bit further, I've read stories about animals that indicate that we've made agreements with other animals so we could sustain a relationship of interdependence with the natural world. What if, for us, these treaties were made with the animals was in fact what we were protecting when we signed Treaty 8. When I said sustaining our way of being, what if it was, you know, because we wanted to ensure that our first, you know, our treaties with the natural world were protected, you know, because if we've maintained our way of being, then those treaties would be protected. So what if we only signed treaties after we were absolutely certain about the treaties that were being made with all the other living things were being honored? What if Treaty 8 facilitated the breaking of these treaties we made with all other living beings? I get scared when I think of the implications of this, that we're breaking treaties with the natural world, but when I look around me, it's abundantly obvious. So reconciliation, I hate this word. Thank you, Government of Canada. But the only real reconciliation worth working towards is reconciliation with the natural world. But how do we do this? How do we reconcile with the spirit of the buffalo? And to put this into perspective, I'm gonna share with you guys one of the most disturbing photos I've ever seen. Can you hit it? Oh, that's just my wall art. That's in my office. This is like what I have in my office. People normally have artwork, right? I have like Tarzan's map, and that's actually a comparison one. That's 2006. And that was 2010. So before and after Harper, I usually call it. That's what I refer to it as. Okay, so this one. This is a photo my chief actually posted on Facebook a few days ago. This is the most disturbing photo I've ever seen. This is a decapitated buffalo. So when I go back home to Fort Chip, we have one herd that sustained us forever. And we want to make sure that they're protected, but where they live is in the proposed site of a new mine, you know? And so this is creating big problems, access problems. Now, because they've done the core drilling, people access these areas, you know, and they're hunting them, and they're doing shit like this to them. The last time, I was in Fort Chip like 2 weeks ago, and we went by Skidoo and went and checked on the buffalo, and people do this, you know, quite often. About a week after I left, our members were checking on the buffalo, and they found this one beheaded. So a living spirited being was killed in the most undignified way on the land that we promised we would take care of. So once again, I ask, like, how do we reconcile with the spirit of the buffalo, or the caribou, or the migratory birds, or the water? So obviously my concern is that we can't, you know, that we've broken these treaties. And I'm not talking Treaty 8, you know, I'm not even gonna get into infringement of Treaty 8 because that means all the animals are gone. You know, like, that's what they're waiting for us to do, is an infringement case. No right to hunt, that means no animals. You know, it's just insane, the shit I deal with, like, on a daily basis. So, that's it, I think. That's it for my presentation. Merci, Cho, for your time.
Thank you to Audrey for welcoming us to your territory and land to have this presentation, and all the SFU staff and Rising Tide, all the organizations and individuals who put this event on. This is really wonderful. I'd just like to introduce our house group and our camp to you. We are one of the newest. We've been in control of our land and resources for the last 8 months. And we are the newcomers, we're the newbies, but when you're in my position, it feels like we've been doing this forever. And, you know, we want to advance quicker than we are, but it takes time. This was about 8 months ago. We went and put up a large gate. We restricted the only access to our territory. And we built a and in addition to the gate there that controls all access, we also built a two-bedroom cabin, what we like to call it. It's about the size of a house, so it can fit a lot of people in it. And we built some other structures, a shelf, woodshed, all that type of stuff, and we have a lot of projects that we would like to do this summer that I will get into in a little bit there. So there's approximately 400 members in our house group, and we do have two different territories. The one territory we completely closed off is on a Patronus is on a collision course with our camp. They are expecting to make a final investment announcement this summer, and we will not be backing down on that. We will keep them off of our land anyway. We worry that they will start developing the pipeline on either end and kind of just work their way and try to squeeze us out. We're hoping additional camps will start up on other ends of the pipeline to just start stopping these pipelines one at a time. And this is a map, just kind of shows where we are in relation to the world here. We're about a little over 200 kilometers away from Unis'tot'en camp, and the colored lines represent the various pipelines that are threatening our part of the world. A little bit about our connection to the land and how our family has always used the land, and there's a lot of corruption within our nation as well. You know, the oppressed have become the oppressors, and that is the mighty dollar of the government issuing treaty societies money, and then these treaty societies that are controlled by people who don't ever go out on the land or use the land. And they're making decisions, and they're trying to duplicate chiefs to try to say there's two chiefs now, and you know, just finding other people who will sign documents for them to give them a mandate, and that oppressive behavior has really pushed us to a point where we have to change our lives to go and protect our land and to stop this social injustice. Before this, I had worked, I had a different vision, I had a different dream. I outright owned two houses and vehicles. I was gonna rent both of those out, buy a third, and go on Easy Street. But all of this stuff had made me stop chasing that dream and change it to come defend our land and our territory and Mother Earth and the water and the fish. So and our house is original plaintiffs in the legendary Delgamuukw Gusteewa court case, and that was a land claim court case. And right now the territories in yellow are the ones that are very supportive of what we are doing, and they don't want to be in the treaty process, and in fact they are in litigation to get out of the treaty process, and that's a spoke litigation. And so within our nation we are very well supported, and not just our nation, our local surrounding communities and everything. And right now we're just trying to get awareness and get into the larger urban areas and have them know about us and assist us, because we live in a very rural area and the area is economically challenged. And yeah, we have a lot of activities out there for like youth and elders to come out. We welcome anybody from all walks of life to come out to learn about what we're doing and to come assist us in developing a community. Essentially, is what we're going to be doing out there. We are proposing to build an 8-bedroom bunkhouse, a greenhouse, a garden. We have people working on the garden greenhouse stuff as we speak. We are looking at advancing our position legally as well as on expanding our camp on the ground. And there's what we have for our camp now. And you see that bridge there, that's the only access point into our territory at this point. You could, it's right at a fork sort of bottlenecks there, and we choked that off. And then we built a permanent structures there. And that was, I believe, at our grand opening, an aerial photo of them. And yeah, we're very concerned about the mouth of the Skeena River where the terminal is going to be for multiple reasons. Flora Banks, Lidu Island, all the tankers. A lot of people don't know that, you know, these tankers, they will carry the fluid out, but then they can't travel back empty, so they'll suck up this seawater in Malaysia or China, bring it back to our part of the world, empty it out and refill and travel back again. So it will be very destructive to our salmon habitat and so many different communities that rely on it. So we have to protect the water and the fish. And yeah, I kind of already mentioned Petronas is going to be making their financial announcement whether they're going to invest in this pipeline, and they've asked the contractors to resubmit bids, and they're going to make a decision here in the next couple months. So it's going to be a very interesting summer, and we're looking for support. Plus we support all other people, not just in British Columbia, or not just First Nations, but everybody from all walks of life, from all around the world. I think we can all make a lot of change united. And for more information on our activities, what we are doing, who we are, what we're planning, you could visit our website, www.maddielee.com. And I did bring some stickers and some buttons. There should be enough buttons for everybody. They're just out in the front where you first come in. I've got a big bag, so if you want to stop, make sure to grab a button. That would be great, and share the word. All right, thank you all.
Well, thank you very much to all of you panelists. This is a phenomenal set of presentations.
I just wanted to announce that the Oyantanapa, the 43 Mexican Indigenous students that have disappeared, they're having a fundraiser. The families are going to be coming up soon too, sometime in April. But right now they're having a fundraiser for the families. It's going to be at the Russian Hall at 8, I'm pretty sure 8, but somebody can Google it, I think it's 8. But it's going to have dancing and information and things, so everybody come out and support if you're not busy doing things here.
All right, thank you very much. So we have just a couple of minutes for a few questions. If you are going to ask a question, please really try to be brief and to the point. After we have the questions, we will have a 5-minute break, and then we'll be back to hear from Glenn Coulthard. So please.
Thank you. My name is Claudio Ekdal. I was born in traditional Mapuche territories in what is known today as southern Chile. And the Mapuche people, as well as indigenous nations all throughout the Americas, are fighting very similar battles. Perhaps one issue that was very particular to the Mapuche people is the repression of the state that has been ongoing since colonialism, but really deepened during the military neoliberal dictatorship, was that they have been facing anti-terrorist legislation. And the terrorist legislation has been applied against their struggle, against their people, against their leaders, against their organizations. unfortunately, this anti-terrorist legislation has been used against the Mapuche people by the so-called democratic governments, or what I call neoliberal regimes, that have come after the military dictatorship. Many people have been incarcerated, paid witnesses protected by the courts, have been used to tell the courts that the Mapuche are violent people, and thus they use the excuse that the Mapuche in their struggle are violent, to repress them and to throw them and lock away the throw away the key, lock them and throw away the key with their anti-terrorist legislation. And I say that that was something very particular to the Mapuche people and their struggle, but unfortunately we see now with the Harper government that these type of policies, these type of repressive policies are coming to Canada and particularly are going to be faced at the forefront by Indigenous, by First Nations people that are at the forefront on the struggle to defend Mother Nature and to defend the rights of all. So I would like your comments on this legislation. Thank you.
Just quickly, I guess, we've been fighting the state and the industry long before Bill C. 51 was even thought of. We've experienced Bill 51 since the beginning of colonization. We have no intention of ever backing down from any challenges that come towards us that threaten our livelihood, our way of seeing our world, and the animals and the plants and the waters that share that world with us. So we're hell-bent on protecting what's left of this planet because our unborn are depending on us to do that. So Bill C-51 can disappear and or it can be enacted, we don't care. We're still gonna be resisting and living in a land and decolonizing our children and grandchildren.
The federal government, or the provincial government, don't have jurisdiction on unceded Wet'suwet'en land.
I know firsthand that the Canadian government targets. I spent jail time, you know, they took me away from my children, they targeted me, those days turned into weeks, into weeks and into months, and I know firsthand that what Canada's plan is to do is to like repress us so hard for us to give up. But it just makes us stronger. It just makes us stronger. Like being a target right now, all of us up here, we're all targets, but we can't stop. We can't stop because it's our responsibility, it's in who we are. And we need people to start taking more action and confronting this. And we risk our freedom. We risk our lives when we stand up. You heard of the people from, you know, South and Central America. It's their lives that they put at stake. So I want to say too, like it's been here forever. They're making a big thing, but we need to know that and know firsthand that we are, you know, we are fighting the terrorists. Like my grandpa says, we are fighting the terrorists, and that's the country of Canada.
C-51, and this is to quote my buddy off Twitter, at the Gwich'in Chris. He said that Aboriginal is our terrorist name. You know, that's a legally given name to us by the government that does not identify who we are. And so, you know, if we're going to be terrorists just for protecting the land and for honoring the agreements we made with the animals before, you know, Europeans or colonizers, whoever came over, then so be it. I mean, with them on the ground, so the shit goes down.
I think it's just like a fear-mongering tactic. It's just a scare tactic to make people into, you know, force people into silence. And I think I had to get over that fear a long time ago, and I refuse for a bill like this to make me scared. I refuse for it to silence me. So the Harper government will go shove it up his ass. So.
To me, BC-51 is just another tactic by the government to put a muzzle on people and to scare and intimidate people. Charitable organizations are scared to even come close to us. We are exercising title. I don't necessarily refer to what we're doing as a blockade as well. Rather that, you know, this is our land, this is our resources, and we're out here using it, and Bill C-51 will prevent a lot of people from even coming near us or supporting us.
Mm-hmm. for what you do and for being here and sharing your words. I actually just have a quick announcement. Melissa, you mentioned the Northern Trappers Alliance in Northern Saskatchewan that are fighting uranium mining and tar sands mining in Dene Nation. There's going to be a fundraiser on April 11th at the Grand Calvary Baptist Church at 7 o'clock, raising funds for food and supplies for the camp. Brian Grandbois of the Dene Nation will be speaking, Audrey will be speaking, and Grand Chief Stuart Phillips. So hope to see you there.
Thank you very much. I don't really want to ask a question. I just wanted to say, as an African who lives on Aboriginal title, I'm beginning to feel that there's a lot of places where we can collaborate and work together. And perhaps I'm very inspired by, you know, the young lady who's saying, she's kind of realized that state law and statute often tramples, you know, customary, you know, other forms of ways of living. And I think the sooner we realize this, I think the better for all of us. And I think the time has come for us to question English law. There's something wrong with English jurisprudence. And this is the jurisprudence that has been used to obliterate, you know, what we are about, you know, what we essentially are. And that you're struggling with issues around earth jurisprudence, and you're asking yourself, how do animals order their lives? You know, what law do they use? Why do they fly to the east and duck from one tree to the next, and so on and so forth? I think there's a lot of value in coming to learn from Africa, you know, some of those, you know, the difficult questions that you're asking yourself. There is huge opportunity in interacting with, you know, African forest people, indigenous sacred forest, you know, lifestyles, you know, for you to kind of get answers to some of those questions. The civilization here is too fast and too loud, you know, sometimes to even give room for silence, you know, to kind of just get to understand things. When we talk about land issues, I think one of the things we sometimes forget is that there are issues of history that we will never run away from. And I think we've attempted to run, you know, so fast from them. But every time we run, we kind of just get back to the same dot. We have to do restitution, you know, on this land question. And there's going to have to be a fight. I don't think it's going to be easy. Those who think you can do this peacefully, you know, probably daydreaming, because capital isn't going to watch you do a dialogue. There's no roundtable that communities that live in those areas that you're depicting over there can do with a huge fracking operation. You know, there's no negotiation, you know, they call it negotiation in English jurisprudence, that you can do when the balance is tilted, you know, against you, you know, so badly. So the sooner we start to mobilize our numbers, and this struggle must be done in the city here. This struggle cannot be done in the trenches there if nothing is happening up here in the city. Because the communal areas in these cities where you see poverty are a direct result of what has happened out there. And so if we don't link these battles, it's not going to be easy for, you know, success to ensue from this. And I think there's a lot of encouragement, and there's a lot that you can learn from Africa. Because in Africa, we are talking about land redistribution. I mean, there are people who are holding so much land that they don't need. And if you survey the kind of things you're talking about, there are companies that are holding so much land that has been conceded to them, and for the last 30 years, they have not used it. And if they've used it, they're probably using only 10%. What's wrong with having land use management plans that can enable them to use just what they need, and, you know, the rest of the land that they don't need is given back to territories. You know, so these are dialogues around which we can, you know, collaborate. I just wanted to encourage, you know, all of you, there's so much that we can learn from each other. it's amazing that, you know, you kind of Canada with all its development still has the agrarian questions as they were. I mean, they are still as agrarian as they were in the 60s. You know, very little has changed, and the more things change, the more they, you know, they seem to be the same. The agrarian question of capital is still dogging you, and the agrarian question of labor is still dogging the society. So I think we need to find each other, you know, so that we begin to organize and talk about how we can support society. Thank you.
A final comment, and then we'll wrap up the session.
Decía una compañera que se llama Betty Cariño, que asesinaron, que es tiempo de nosotros, los pueblos.
Compañera Betty Cariño once said, it's our time.
Y en ese sentido, después de escuchar a los compañeros de las Naciones de Canadá, nos queda más claro todavía en el corazón que tenemos que luchar juntos.
After listening to our friends here from Indigenous nations here in Canada, it is ever more clear to us that we need to struggle together.
El gobierno de Canadá, las empresas de Canadá, nuestros gobiernos presumen de las virtudes de la minería en Canadá, y ustedes lo están desmitificando, lo están aflorando.
The Canadian government, Canadian mining companies, our governments talk a lot about the benefits and the supposed good things of Canadian mining companies, but you guys have just made it very clear, you've busted those myths and told us what's really going on.
Y entonces es momento de que luchemos juntos. La lucha de ustedes en sus pueblos es la misma lucha que ustedes tienen que hacer en mi pueblo y que nosotros tenemos que hacer en el pueblo de Luis y de la compañera Choca en Guatemala.
And so the struggle that you have in your communities is the same struggle that we have in our communities and that Luis has in his communities in Ecuador, that Angelica Choca has in her communities in Guatemala, and is the reason why we need to struggle together.
Mi propuesta muy concreta es, sigamos la batalla desde lo local con la diferencia de las luchas que tenemos, pero hagamos una o dos estrategias juntos, que sea la misma desde el sur hasta el norte.
My concrete proposal would be that, well, we need to carry on our particular struggles in each of our communities according to the particularities of those places. Why don't we try to find at least one or two particular strategies that we can share in common in each place where we're struggling? Woo!
Demostrémosles que por más leyes que hagan para que eviten juntarnos, no lo van a lograr. Y entonces pongámonos de acuerdo con una o dos acciones concretas para que avancemos en esta lucha global contra lo global.
They can make all the laws that they like, but they can't stop us from joining together. So let's try to come up with a couple of strategies that we can implement at the same time.
Bravo!
I just want to say, I think that also people need to think about extraction not only in terms of the Canadian. We always think oil or liquid fracked gas, things like that. Extraction is also logging. I live in the last low-lying temperate rainforest on the planet, and they are logging our old-growth forests, and we need help. Extraction is also what the Hiltzik are fighting with the herring, and the DFO are going in and stealing their fish. Extraction is also when they are stealing our air, the air that we breathe with their pollution. So we need to really rethink that extraction means all of this and so much more. They're extracting lives and they're extracting our futures. So we really, really have to think about in a broader sense of the world. It's not just oil and it's not just pipelines. It's our rainforests, it's our ocean, it's our fish. So please just keep that in mind when we're thinking about this, the state of extraction It means so much more than just oil and just pipes. It means the very way of life that we all are struggling to keep for our future. Okay.
This session to an end, but I don't want to end abruptly. If there are any final comments that the panelists would like to make, or
okay, I'll tell you guys the end, the real end of the story with the mouse.
Yeah.
I didn't want to tell it to you guys because I was scared it made me start crying or make you guys start crying. So what happened to the mouse after while he was undoing the snare, while he was gnawing away at the snare, he actually got burnt by the sun and he died. That's the principles that we're driving. And so I kind of left out that really critical part, because it's really just, you should hear me tell a joke. So I'll let you derive the principles from that story.
Thank you. So on that note, please join me in thanking again.